People always say that New York was the fifth character of Sex and the City, but that's only a half-truth. New York was never fully there, because in reality, half of the city's population is Black and Latinx. Those faces never showed up on screen. Throughout history, white people have always had easier access to roles of power in the entertainment industry, and racialized issues always take the back seat. So it's no surprise that in popular film and TV, when we see gentrifying cities on screen, the populations hurt by that process are completely erased.
I'm walking here!
Take Robert Mitchell's Notting Hill. It's a beloved 90s rom-com, and much of the appeal comes from its idealized London background. But Notting Hill, the real-life place, is a district in West London where so much of the city's Black population lives. Almost none of them are visible in the film. In one of the film's most iconic moments, William strolls through the Portobello Road Market in despair as the seasons change to show the passage of time. The sequence highlights signature moments of each season, like buying Christmas trees in the winter. Very few of the vendors and market-goers are Black, and beyond that, Black traditions are invisibilized. The Notting Hill Carnival, a massive annual celebration of the British West Indian community, would have been a logical choice for summer, but instead, summer is just represented by an abundance of flowers. And when you realize that Notting Hill's Black population has decreased by over 40% since Robert Mitchell excluded them from his film, it becomes clearer how white directors, writers, and producers can be complicit in real-life gentrification. But in contrast to these examples, there are also some by Black filmmakers that tackle gentrification head-on. Many of these have come out of the San Francisco Bay Area, one of the most rapidly gentrifying regions in the country. The protagonists are Black and working-class people who confront the tension of watching their homes change around them. City montages, complete with upbeat music and recognizable tourist attractions, are a staple of popular filmmaking. But some directors use the opening minutes of their films to show a different side of their cities. In Boots Riley's Sorry to Bother You, Cassius Green drives from his home in a garage to his new job in downtown Oakland, puttering past homeless encampments and liquor stores in his beat-up car. In The Last Black Man in San Francisco by Joe Talbot, Jimmy and Mont skateboard from the polluted waters of the bay to the heart of San Francisco. They pass by unappealing construction sites, illustrating the way the city builds into Black neighborhoods and pushes people out. But both Riley and Talbot are doing much more than just showing the difficulties of people who are often ignored in film. They're celebrating those people. Beautiful, smooth, slow-motion shots portray joyful Black faces at the beginning of Jimmy and Mont's journey, then judgmental white faces as they enter gentrified areas. The Black residents enjoy themselves, not minding Jimmy and Mont's presence, while the white people address the camera and therefore the characters, showing their distaste. In Sorry to Bother You, Cassius's home is filled with soft, warm light and calming patterns. He's comfortable within this space. But his office space is cold, claustrophobic, and bland, because when he ventures into downtown Oakland, corporations control the narrative.
When you claim that money, it's a sale. Cha-ching.
Carlos Lopez Estrada's Blindspotting uses color in a similar way. In a lighthearted comedic scene, two lifelong best friends, one Black and one white, enter a Black beauty salon to try to sell hair straighteners to a room full of women. Even though they bicker for the whole scene, there is once again a feeling of comfort from within the audience and the characters, emphasized by the colorful, warm tones that paint the vibrant room. This is their space, seemingly untouched by gentrification. Later in the film, the main characters go to a party in a big new house filled mostly with white people. The scene oozes with tension and discomfort as Colin and Miles feel insulted by the way the white guests claim the city of Oakland. Miles is especially furious to see a gentrifier with the same tattoo as him. The scene is drenched in cold blue lighting, which again emphasizes the way the protagonists are made to feel like outsiders in their own city.
Thank you.
Anytime. You take care. Come on in.
He has the same tattoo.
Shut the fuck up.
It's called gentrification. It's what happens when the property value of a certain...
Gregory Mantsios writes that those who own and direct the mass media are themselves part of the upper class, and neither they nor the ruling class in general have to composite to manipulate public opinion. Their interest is in preserving the status quo. Ultimately, a film industry that is more truthful about diverse issues will emerge from more diversity behind the camera. And when it comes to gentrification in particular, it will require the centering of the gentrified, not the gentrifiers. If you're going to say-